go. Caleb, go ahead and turn the light on. First things first, I've been praying nonstop since this morning started. But I haven't prayed for us. So let's do that. Heavenly Father, we just come before you, Lord. Father, with praise and adoration, a very thankful heart. Lord, as we observe Resurrection Day, Lord. Lord, the day that you took away our sins. Lord, that you made everything right. That you made everything right between us and you. Father, it was nothing that we could do, nothing that we could overcome, accomplish. Father, nothing that we could do with our own works. But Lord, it was all because of what you did. Lord, we as man, we as humans can just royally mess things up. You have showed us the way of life and life more abundantly. And Father, I thank you so much for that. Lord, as I start here this morning, I pray this in your heavenly name. Amen. So, as most of you know, last year when I did this, I thought, okay, Lord, this is what you put on my heart. This is what I'll do. This year, as Kurt asked me to step in this morning, God said, it's a continuation. And you need to put it in a book. I hope when I read this that I do it justice. I've been working on this. I've been working on the idea for several months now. God has actually been bringing it to me for several months, and me trying to put everything down on paper and has been a challenge. And last night I was chapter 2 of Jesus Through the Eyes of. How unworthy you feel. Have you cried out to God, Adonai, why me, Lord? What makes me so special? Why do you think that I am worth this task? Why do you want me? Why me? I have asked this question over and over throughout my life, but more frequently when I became a husband and a father. Let me tell you that journey. It also. See, not far from our betrothal, something absolutely astonishing happened. Before our marriage was consummated, even actually before we were married, she was found to be with child. I don't want to disgrace my family by bringing a loose woman into our family. If you only knew my family and my family. I can trace my family all the way back to Father Abraham. Oh, and let's not forget King David and his son, King Solomon. They are my great, 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 great. Well, let's just say there's 28 generations back. My blood was actually royal blood here in Israel. We are a proud people serving the one true God, Adonai. Oh, the stories my family can tell. Oh, sorry, where was I? Yes, yes. So I was dismissed her quietly. Then one night, while sleeping, an angel of Adonai came to me in a dream. That dream was so vivid and so real. The angel said to me, Son of David, don't be afraid to take her as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Adonai himself. The angel went to say she would give birth to a son. and his name would be Yeshua. For he will save the people from their sins. Now, this dream really hit me hard. Like I said, my family is important in our community, and strong Hebrew family. And all my life, I've been attending synagogue meetings, and I remember the reading of the scrolls of the prophet Isaiah. It said, "Behold, the virgin will conceive, and she will give birth to a son. She will call his name Emmanuel, God with us." Well, when I awoke, I was confused. I was amazed, honored, and feeling very unworthy. I asked the Lord, "Why me? Why did you choose me for this task?" But I did just as the angel of Adonai commanded me. I took her as my wife. Now, just to complicate things a little more, before the baby arrived, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that the registration of the world inhabitants be taken. So my very pregnant wife and I traveled from Galilee of Nazareth to Judea, the city of Bethlehem, since, like I said, I was from the house and lineage of David. She was traveling okay, but by the time we got to the city, she was very uncomfortable and having severe pains. Now, since all of my family was in town as well, staying with them was kind of out of the question. And finding another house to stay at was nearly impossible. There was just no room. Well, getting worse in the pain, and she told me, "It's time." We ended up spending the night in a stable. It was a dry, warm place to sleep. However, there wasn't much sleeping going on that night because the baby boy we were expecting came. I was beside myself. First off, what kind of father was I? That our baby was being born in a barn. Not just any baby, but the Son of God. Was I going to be able to give this boy a fitting life of a king the angel said he would be? Greater than King David? These thoughts and questions were interrupted by the strangest thing. Shepherd boy. As you can imagine, they said, I was blown away. They said an angel of the Lord appeared to them that very night, telling them that they were to come and worship the king. I was wondering if this was the same angel that appeared to me in my dream. Now, as Hebrew tradition and the law of Moses, 8 days, on the eighth day, we took him to Jerusalem to present him to Adonai. We had to do this since the Torah says that the firstborn boy who opens the womb shall be called holy to Adonai, just as the angel of the Lord instructed. We used his name, Yeshua. While we were there at the temple, a man by the name of Simeon came running. The Spirit of the Lord told him to find us, that he would find us here at the temple. He said the Spirit told him that the Messiah was here. He told us that Adonai told him he would not die before he saw Christ, the Christ child. He took him in his arms and blessed him. Well, as you can imagine, my wife and I were baffled at this situation. He kept saying that our son was going to be the Savior of the world. The world! And he looked at my wife and told her, "Behold, this one is destined to cause the fall and rise of many in Israel, and to be a sign that it is opposed, so that the thoughts of many hearts may be uncovered. And even for you, a source, your soul. Just as soon as he finished speaking, a prophetess came over and began praising God, speaking about our boy and all those waiting for the redemption of Jerusalem. Now, let me tell you, as crazy as this sounds, this is not the craziest thing that has happened. Later on, I think he was either two or three. We had a huge entourage come to our house in Bethlehem. It was wise men, kings from the far east. They followed a star of all things and found us. They traveled a very long way to come and worship our son. They also brought gifts, but weird gifts to present to Yeshua. They didn't stay long, but they had been warned in a dream to return to their country by another path. And after they had left, an angel appeared to me in a dream again. The angel told me to take my child and wife and flee to Egypt and stay there until I was instructed to do so. Well, we did this. And just when we did, the previous times, the angel appeared to me in a dream telling me it was safe to return. Well, I couldn't risk returning back to Jerusalem. So instead, we went to Galilee, to a very nice village called Nazareth. I don't remember who it was that told me, but this decision actually fulfilled Scripture. And Yeshua would be called a Nazarite. Well, let me tell you, I was overwhelmed. It would be bad enough for me to move around all the time, but here I was moving my family with me as well. But thankfully, I was able to build a house and put down roots here. I know some of you are thinking, if my son was supposed to be the King of Kings, he must have been a great, well-behaved boy. To answer your question, yes, he was a very well-behaved Hebrew boy, but he also got into mischief and played like most boys. But you could tell he was different. He was so sharp with the knowledge of Scripture. I can think of an example. We were in Jerusalem to observe the Passover feast, and it was the first one that he could participate in. Well, when we headed back in the caravan, we thought Yeshua was with the other kids, just playing and having fun. At the end of the first day's journey, we discovered that he was not with us. His mother and I immediately went back to Jerusalem and found him. We looked all over town, going from house to house. Our relatives thinking he might have gone there if he had gotten left or strayed away. We looked for him for 3 days. I don't think I'd have told you how distraught his mother was. Well, we finally found him. He was sitting in the temple, sitting in the center of all the teachers, listening to them and asking questions. He was baffling and making them question themselves. He knew the Scriptures better than they did. Well, when his mother got a hold of him, let me tell you what. Yes, dear. Oh, I'm going to turn this over to the story to my wife to finish. Well, as my husband said, we had just found Yeshua at the temple. I was not very happy. I think most of you know a mother's wrath. Well, I said to him, "Child, why did you do this to us? Your father and I were searching frantically, Now his response, I got to say, just took all the anger and frustration out of me and baffled me at the same time. He looked me in the eye and said, why were you searching all over for me? Did you not know that I must be about my Father's things? Well, what did he mean by this? Priest? I might not have grasped that, but I treasured those words in my heart later. He was a very obedient boy and was oh so smart. You could easily tell that he had favor of Adonai upon him, and even men showed him favor. When he became a man, as we were sitting there eating, I overheard the servants talking about how they were already out of wine. So I told that servant, just hang on a second. And I looked over at my son and told him they were out of wine. He looked at me and said, woman, what does this have to do with you and me? My hour has not yet come. I just looked at and told them to do whatever he told them to do. Well, he told them water and fill 6 large stone jars with water. Water! He told them after they did this to take some to the head waiter. Now, the head waiter had no idea where this drink had come from. But when he tasted it, he immediately went to the bridegroom. He was amazed that normally people serve the best wine first, but this was the best wine he had ever tasted, and it was being served last. I don't need to tell you that I was a proud mother, but I myself was astonished as well. Yeshua had a habit of doing that to me, astonishing me, that is. One day I heard that he was in a nearby town and his brothers and I traveled to see him. He was in a room talking and teaching. I was able to get the attention of one of his close friends and told them that we were trying to get in to see him. His friend went back in and told him that we were outside. He said, the strangest thing. He said, brother, and who are my brothers? He stretched out his arms and said, here are my brother, here are my mother, and here are my brothers. For whoever does the will of my Father in heaven, he is my brother and sister and mother. I kind of understood this, but I also didn't. Yeshua was always traveling around. I would see him from time to time. But his father and I also got word that the leaders of the temple were not happy with Yeshua, and they were trying to plot against him. Well, it finally happened. A mother's worst nightmare. We were all in Jerusalem for the Passover. Yeshua came several days before, and the people were celebrating him. They escorted him into town like royalty. It was just as the Passover celebration, they were going to make him the king of Israel. Well, as he was accustomed in the last few years, he and his friends celebrated Passover together. I always thought this was kind of strange, because it was a time for family to celebrate together, just like the first Passover. And the families were doing so together. I wondered if he was worried about his family would embarrass him in front of his friends. I don't know. Anyway, I got word the next morning that Yeshua had been arrested and was taken to see Caiaphas, the high priest. Well, I rushed out of the house to the high priest, but on my way I heard a crowd saying they had taken Yeshua to the governor's palace to go before Pilate. I rushed over there and was able to stand in the back of the crowd, but I could still hear what was being said. the priests were shouting all different accusations about how he was a blasphemer and making threats to tear down the temple. Pilate tried to talk to him, and he asked him if he was the king of the Jews. All Yeshua would say was, "You have just spoken it." Pilate tried several times to get him to talk, but to no avail. And as is custom during Passover, he offered a pardon. He offered to pardon Yeshua. But the crowd was loud and drowned out my pleas. They were shouting, "Give us Yeshua Barabbas." Pilate was trying to persuade them to let my Yeshua go. But the crowd was loud and demanding. They wanted Barabbas. What happened next? What's the worst thing a mother can hear about their baby boy? My heart was broke. I felt like all the life was draining out of my body. When Pilate asked what to be done with Yeshua, the crowd became even louder and more violent, shouting, "Crucify him!" They kept shouting this over and over. I was shocked, crushed. I remember thinking, no, they can't do this to Adonai. Adonai would not let this happen to his son. As they led him away, I just stood there. I couldn't move. I couldn't think. I couldn't even fully comprehend what was taking place. His dear friend John came up to me and confronted me. However, he was as lost as I was as to what was taking place. The Roman soldiers took Yeshua to the corner of the courtyard. They stripped off his outer clothes, and they were laughing and taunting him. They started whipping him. You could hear the sound of the whip as it tore the loose flesh from his body. Some of them even beat them with their swords in his face. That beautiful, loving face of my baby boy. John and some others were pulling me back, not wanting me to see what was going on. I went with them, but not before I saw my son, bloody and beaten. They had thrown a purple robe around his neck and placed a crown of thorns on his head. Why? Why was the Almighty allowing this to take place? Even before he was born, when the angel of Adonai came to see me, he told me that Yeshua was the son of Adonai. He was to be the next king, not only of Israel, but of the whole world. He was sent here to save the people from their sins. How is he supposed to do that now? Why did the priests enrage this crowd like that? They were just praising and adoring him just a few days ago. And now? Now they were shouting, "Crucify him." They wanted him dead. We saw as they were leading him to the place outside the city to hang on a stake. He was stumbling, trying his best to carry the beam strapped to his shoulders. But my heart was absolutely breaking. I was screaming and crying, trying my best to get away from the men holding me back from rushing him. The soldiers finally pulled somebody out of the crowd to carry the beam for him. They cut the cords on the strap that strapped it to him, and he fell. He was barely moving. Bloody, beaten, and broken, he stumbled along the road. When they arrived at the place called the Skull, men took these long nails and nailed him to the poles. But Yeshua was just crying out in pain. My heart was being ripped out of the chest, out of my chest, right in front of me. As they raised the pole into position and dropped in the hole, the jolt hurt him so much, I could see it on his face. Then one of the soldiers climbed up the ladder and nailed the sign right above him. It read, Yeshua HaNazarati, the King of the Jews. After some time passed, the crowd was clearing off. John and I, as well as some close friends, ventured closer. As we approached, Yeshua looked at me and said, Woman, behold your son. Then he looked at John and said, Behold your mother. Yeshua looked at the soldiers and told them he was thirsty. They were laughing as they raised up a sponge, dipped in what looked like wine, but from where I stood smelled a lot like it was sour, like a vinegary smell. They rubbed it on his lips, splashed it in his face. These cruel, cowardly men were just laughing at what they were doing. Some even casting lots for his clothes. But then Yeshua cried out in a loud voice, Adonai, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. And all of a sudden, the sky went dark. Like it was twilight, the sun just dimmed. People were startled and confused. No one had ever seen anything like this. Then Yeshua said, It is finished. And he let out a large sigh. Why? Why did they do this to him? What had he actually done to deserve this? What kind of evil people were these? About an hour before sundown, because it was a Sabbath, was the next day. The soldiers broke the legs of the other two men who were being crucified on either side of Yeshua. But when they went to him, he was already gone. One of the soldiers took a spear and stuck it into his side. Blood and water came pouring out and spilling all over the ground. Then they took the bodies down. This nice young man by the name of Joseph came up to me. He explained that he was from Arimathea, and he was a student of my son. He was a wealthy man, and he had purchased a new burial tomb to place Yeshua in. Another nice young man by the name of Nicodemus brought 100 pounds of a mixture of burial spices to help Joseph. The tomb was very close by, so they had everything done before sundown. And a large stone was rolled in front of the tomb. The soldiers were standing guard, as Pilate had ordered. John then took me home. I was physically and emotionally finished. At the time, I had just felt numb. I couldn't process what I had just witnessed this horrible day. Was this all a dream? A nightmarish dream? Was Adonai punishing me? I don't really remember the next few days. I slept a lot and just kind of went through the motions. I was just done. But then, on the first day of the week, first thing in the morning, some girls that followed dear friends of Yeshua, came running back from finishing the burial process. They were shouting and cheering and carrying on, saying that Yeshua was alive. He was no longer in the tomb. They said that an angel of Adonai was there in the tomb, and they told him that he had risen. He had risen. Could this be possible? Could he really be alive? Then his disciples came to me and told me that they had seen him. They said, He has risen. He has risen indeed. Well, Easter has always been a interesting time of year. Caleb, you can turn on the rest of the lights. Interesting time of year for me. In my own mind, I read through this story and I understand the story and the pain and suffering that went on with those around him. And yet we celebrate this time. And in my own mind, it's hard to decipher the difference between celebrating the pain and suffering, but it's because of what he did. And it's just hard for me to kind of comprehend at times, because I think, well, why are we celebrating pain and suffering? But it's because of what he did. And yes, he went through the pain and he suffered. But because of that, we have eternal life. We have life in him. Like I said, it took me a while to write this one. And the biggest message out of the whole Easter story, to me, it's found in Revelation. It's found in Revelation chapter 5, verse 6. And in the midst of the throne and the four living creatures, in the midst of the elders, I saw a lamb standing as it has been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. He came and took the scroll from the right hand of the one seated at the throne. When he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each holding a harp and a golden bowl of incense, which the prayers of the Spirit. They were singing a new song, saying, "You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals. You were slain by your blood. You are the Redeemer for God. Those of every people, every tribe, every tongue, and every nation. You have made them for our God, the kingdom and the Spirit. They shall reign upon the earth. Worthy is the Lamb who is slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing. To the one seated on the throne and the Lamb be blessing and honor, glory and power forever and ever." And the four living creatures kept saying, "Amen." And the elders fell down and worshiped. That, to me, is what Easter is all about, what resurrection is all about. I have one last song to play. It's an old one. Caleb, you want to go ahead and go? You can get it started up. The computer is being kind of tricky, so... if it shuts the live stream off, that is perfectly fine. Before we play the song, if anyone needs prayer, we can come up and we can pray afterwards. But if you are not, if you do not know who Christ is, and don't have that relationship, please get in touch with me, Kurt, anybody here in the church, and we can sure help you with that. Because without him, there is no hope. There is no life. You're just going through the motions. So I want to close in prayer, and then I'll have Caleb play one last song. You find it there? Yeah, that's fine. So let's have a word of prayer. Father God, we just thank you. Father, I thank you so much for your son. Lord, I can't imagine what it was like. Lord, knowing that your son was shedding blood through his tears. He took on the brutal beating. Lord, he did that for me and everybody here. Lord, I just thank you. I thank you for the cross. I thank you for our salvation. I thank you that you took care of it. Even though we're the ones that messed up, you took care of it once and for all. And when Jesus said, "It is finished," it was finished. Father, I just ask that you be with us as we venture on today. Lord, keep us safe. Be with Kurt and Deb as they are traveling. Lord, we thank you. Can't thank you enough for all that you do for us, Lord. Father, in your heavenly name, in the name of Yeshua, I pray.
In the heat of the early morning, on a hill they call the skull, the roaring of the angry mob had settled to a lull. All eyes were cast upon the man whose hands and feet were bound. They saw him cry in anguish when they heard the his head was crowned. They watched the bloody cross of wood be dropped into the ground. The soldiers knelt before his clothes. They watched him win it.
thank you all for putting up. Have a blessed day.